The just-concluded state legislative session included a series of tax cuts for businesses and individuals. Lawmakers also killed a tax credit measure designed to help Arizona grow its film industry. Here to tell us if the legislature did the right things to grow the state's economy is Glenn Hammer, president and CEO of the Arizona Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Barry Broome, president and CEO of the Greater Phoenix Economic Council, and ASU economist Dennis Hoffman, who directs the Seidman Research Institute for the W.P. Carey School of Business. Good to have you all here. Thanks for joining us.
Great to be here, Glenn.
Let's start, Glenn, with an overall view of the session from a business standpoint. What did you see?
It was a fantastic session, Ted. We passed the second annual once-in-a-generation competitiveness package. And, of course, I'm kidding a little bit there, but we built very smartly on the tax reform package that passed last year. We added a very sizable capital gains tax reform, net operating loss. We made some of the tax credits that passed in the last several years more usable. There's a very important infrastructure bill that also passed. And additionally, we made additional progress on civil justice reform, regulatory reform. It was a spectacular session. The last 48 hours broke the right way.
All right. And I want to get to some of these ideas that you mentioned in a second here. But overall, Barry, from a bird's eye view, what did you see?
I thought it was very good. I think, you know, Glenn, you know, summarized it in a really important way. I think a lot of the policies that the legislature passed this time were much more strategic and impactful on things like export industries. We also had the elective sales factor for service industries, which people refer to as the Apollo bill. But, you know, service industries are becoming much more complex. They're exporting resources and services abroad. They're now getting treated like an Intel or a Honeywell or a Boeing. Expanding the investment tax credit from the renewable industry to all export industries was a very smart, aggressive move. And the 9,000 job tax credit is now uncapped, so a company like Apple that would come in here and create 4,000 jobs would actually get the benefit of all the tax credits. And then some of the environmental issues that Glenn brought up I thought were also very impactful.
Okay, Dennis, what did you see this session?
Well, I think I defer to my colleagues here in terms of the detail and deliverables for businesses. I think that's a great thing. I think that business, we need to be very kind to business in the state, that businesses create our jobs. And I've always been a supporter of having a very kind tax and regulatory environment when it comes to businesses. Now, I would say in terms of the session, I saw some pluses, and some of it is addition by subtraction. You know, we're not in an environment where we're making massive cuts, and being on the front line with a lot of those cuts in the past, that's a good thing. I think that it was very refreshing to see the legislature, even though they dabbled with these crazy Tabor rules and growth government spending restriction rules, they backed away at the end, and we didn't get those types of regulations. And I think that's very good. It's a signal that the legislature wants to take on that budgeting commitment, and I think that's a very important thing for them to do. And we had some wins, I think, in terms of education, some small wins in terms of education, and got some equity funding for the universities. So, you know, all in all, you know, coupled with the detail you can get from these gentlemen about the benefits that specific benefits that accrue to business, I think it was a good session.
Glenn, let's get to some of those details. The individual corporate capital gains tax cut, how much, what kind of impact?
Well, it'll scale up to 25%. It'll start at 10%, go to 20%, and then I believe 25%. The impact here is, we expect, will be pretty sizable. And Dennis Hoffman has also put together papers on the capital gains tax reform. We have to remember, this is one of the most volatile taxes. One of the neat things is, probably for the first time, we're going to really be able to accurately measure what this tax collects. But this is a great tax reform for those that want to invest capital. And the history on the federal side has been that when capital gains taxes have been cut, more revenue has come in because of the additional activity.
But yet, critics will say capital gains tax cuts usually means, folks, they're not creating jobs. They're not investing in the community or in getting manufacturing, et cetera. They're buying more stocks. They're looking at real estate, these sorts of things. Is that a valid criticism?
Well, it's, you know, the key thing when we work on things like the elective sales factor connected back to export industries or a monetized tax credit for, you know, emerging technology, and they're much easier to measure. I think it's easier to raise questions about the capital gains tax because, you know, it's tougher to track back to activity. But in a state that has a lot of need for liquidity for small businesses, you know, creating an improved transactional environment around technology, you know, there are also some benefits to that you can trace back.
What do you think, Dennis? How easy is it to trace the success of capital gains tax cuts?
Well, now, again, this is these are gains on investments made after December 31st, 2011, as I understand it. So we're not talking about investments that have already been made, that, you know, realizations that, you know, folks could just bring forward. So we're going to have to watch this, I think, very carefully. Glenn's exactly right. My paper pointed to the volatility of this as a source. And actually, the point I made was, it didn't make sense to me to try to fund predictable things like kids in schools, prisoners in prisons, access rolls, university students, very predictable expenses on this roller coaster of capital gains revenues. But of course, my intent was we need to replace this revenue source with something else. And I don't hear any dialogue about replacing it with anything.
Well, let's talk about that as far as concerns with revenue. And obviously, the last session, big jobs bill, big job creation bill, 500 some odd, 538, something like that jobs bill. Now you've got something along those lines. Now you've got these particular incentives and the tax credits and such. Much of this is hitting as a temporary sale, as the proverbial cliff is approaching. Is there a concern regarding revenue?
We need to make sure, Ted, that we really get the Arizona jobs machine going again. Let's take a look at what's happened since last year's bill passed. You know, now CEO Magazine ranks Arizona as one of the top 10 states. That's a big deal. Kaufman ranks us as the number one state in the country when it comes to entrepreneurial activity. As more jobs come back, you could take it to the bank. We're going to see more tax revenue come into this state. That's the religion I'm going to give you. And I'm not, you know, I think we have to be as aggressive as we possibly can so that we replace, and we have begun replacing the 300,000 plus jobs we lost during the Great Recession. And I get a little excited and giddy when I'm sitting across from my colleague Barry Broome, and he has some new tools in the toolbox to play with. We're going to get new jobs because of these reforms.
Does that religion and the revenue that accompanies it, does that equal out to the revenue that could be lost with all of these tax credits, with all these tax cuts?
Yeah, see, I think it's two separate discussions. You know, first off, the economy doesn't make a good bedfellow for politics. You know, when you're competing with people for jobs, you know, you have to sit down and start with a blank slate. You know, we're building a strategy around export industries. It's a global competition. Our competitive footprint has to be determined based upon evidence and what's going on in the marketplace. After you build your competitive footprint, then you have to think about your public responsibilities and your public investments. And I think Glenn's correct. I think improving our public position is going to do a lot to help us improve our public income stream. And the best thing you can do for anybody is to get them a job. And when you get somebody a great paying job, then they're in control of making their own decisions about education and healthcare. But I do want to close by saying I don't want to dismiss the revenue discussion. And I think the revenue discussion really should be centered around what happens when Proposition 100 goes away. And I don't think the answer to Proposition 100 is you repeal the gains made in your business climate. You might need to sit down and talk about how that income gets replaced independent of the growth in the economy, but you don't want to use a tactic to replace that income by shortening your ability to compete for the kind of jobs that Arizona needs.
What do you make of this, Dennis?
Look, these guys are right on the mark. We need to be kind to businesses. We are. And I'm not suggesting we backtrack on that at all. But the model works as follows. You're kind to businesses, they pay good salaries, you bring in high-salaried people, and then you ask those people to pay for public services. Now, politically, that's very challenging. And arithmetically, in the current climate. And Glenn, I like what you're saying. We got to grow jobs. But think about it. Think about the arithmetic. $75,000 a year family of three, one child, two adults. They pay less than $5,000 in combined state and local taxes. If their kid's in school, it just barely covers that expense. They don't pay for anything else. And I'm talking a $75,000 salary. What I am suggesting here is the current tax structure on individuals is insufficient to make this model work.
What do you think about that, Glenn?
Well, it is. I believe that it is working. I mean, if you look at, not that there aren't trade-offs, there are, but if you take a look at what the legislature's done during the last couple of years, they've basically, and a lot of these choices, they were tough choices, but they've basically brought the budget back into structural balance. And I don't believe that Governor Brewer or Speaker Tobin or Senate President Pierce or any of the people that have been working very hard to reform our tax system, to create these new opportunities to bring jobs to this state, should owe anyone an apology, because our revenues are coming back, our jobs are coming back, and I think as the job machine continues to pick up steam, we will see additional revenue.
I've got to interject here. This is not an indictment of our legislature. It's not an indictment of our governor. I think that the politics are really very clear. People, the average citizen doesn't want tax increases, okay? I think that the governor's shown leadership on this point. The legislature's responded. Businesses are pleased. We got more businesses moving here. It's just my worry that we as a people are just not confronting the arithmetic of this challenge.
Well, I think they're kind of both right. Okay, so if you take a look at Virginia, which is the number one business state in the country, individuals are paying higher taxes in Virginia. If you look in our metro competition environment in Salt Lake and in the Denver region, those states' business environments are still, better than ours, not as much, just barely, but those individuals are paying more taxes.
Right.
So the equation is, how do you bring your business environment, because Intel's the best teacher. If you want to know what Intel talks about, Intel says, I need a benefit against my R&D activity. I need a benefit against this capital investment. I need a benefit against this corporate liability. And while you're at it, you got to do something about your schools. Mm-hmm. And sometimes people think from a policymaking mm-hmm. standpoint, boy, your businesses are talking out of both sides of their mouths. I said, they're not. You actually have to do both. This state has to bring the best business environment in the country online and improve schools and universities, and it's a challenge. But I think they've made strides on that, and I think the one point I wanted to make is, in the 1990s, Arizona's legislature cut individual income taxes like 11 times. Now what you
40%.
See... 40%. Well, now 40%. What you see Arizona legislators doing is they're working very precisely on the business tax environment, and I think that's an achievement in the right direction. Glenn?
Well, and I want to first say this certainly was not an indictment on Dennis, but...
he appreciates it.
Yes. He's very very, very bright economist, and I always appreciate hearing.
And my simple point was, I think that our policymakers have got a real political challenge on this. This is not easy.
But it is competitive out there, and even on the individual income tax. Yes, it's true that Arizona has a lower individual income tax than most states, but Texas zero, mm-hmm. Nevada zero. The conversation across America from several states, Kansas, Oklahoma, a number of other states, is how to reduce to zero their individual income taxes. It's not easy. This is a tough business. But if you take a look at where the state is going, huge strides. If you're in an export-oriented mm-hmm. Industry, whether it's capital or it's stuff on the internet, welcome to Arizona, because we beat any state in the country.
You've got about 30 seconds left. With this kind of legislation, does this produce tangible results? And I mean significant tangible, not just here, there, willing, significant results.
Yeah, absolutely it will. And it already has. And I'll give you a good example. What the legislature and the governor's doing now is not only are they building a better business environment, but they're starting to really understand the uniqueness of export industries. And so these policies are much more qualified, they're much more intuitive, And I think this was, I actually think this was almost in some ways a bigger set of legislative achievements than even last year, because it really shows that the legislature and the governor is gaining in their understanding of the economy.
We have to stop it right there. Gentlemen, great discussion. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining
us.
Thank you, Ted. Thank you.